Hey guys, I'm Ted. I'm here to give you another lecture. And for today's lecture, we are going to discuss the end of the colonial war. But before we do so, we're going to do our customary recap and do a quick survey of where we last left off. So in our last lecture, we discussed the conflict. How the conflict escalated between the British and the French. At this point, everybody in the colony is affected. Patriots, loyalists, and they were black, white, German, English, you know, everyone was picking a side. Well, not everybody. Roughly one-third was in support of the colonies rebelling, one-third didn't care, and one-third wanted to remain under British rule, or at least were receiving enough promises from the British to remain loyal to Great Britain and support their war effort. Independence was declared. Saratoga had been fought and won by the Americans. Washington's army was time and time again defeated, but Washington managed to preserve that army. That army had remained intact, more or less. And more importantly, the British were unable to clinch overall victory in the colonies. And even more sinister for the British, the French. The French had decided to enter the war on the side of the Americans. They were not only sending troops, but they were also giving giving the Americans money and arms to fight the British. Now, Washington had managed to keep that ragtag Continental Army together and pose a somewhat military threat to the British field armies operating in North America. Though he endured a series of crushing defeats, most notably at Long Island in 1776 that enabled the British to capture New York City, but also at Brandywine Creek and also at Germantown, both of those battles occurring in 1777. Now, preserving his force through the hard-pressed winter at Valley Forge and conducting raids at Princeton and Trenton sort of enabled Washington to have some credit to his name. But things had not been going good for the Continental Army. Saratoga and Fort Stanwix were the only true military victories. Everything else had been going the British way. The French were coming, but it was widely understood that France's first intentions were to recover one West Indian islands, contest the British in Africa and India, and make a move for Canada. Those were the French objectives. Then those were clearly understood. Now, the Continental Army could not stand up to the British Army in a field fight. Their best survival was to hold out until the war strain got to the British Parliament. Now, the French were watching and waiting, and they were still looking for the right moment to strike out at the British. And also, they were trying to entice the Spanish to join them in this war against the British. No one liked to go to a fight by themselves. Now, the French, they were aided in convincing the Spanish and other European powers to isolate and then gang up on Great Britain, because everybody had been embarrassed by Great Britain during the 7 Years' War. The only European power to emerge really with an enhanced reputation and to really just emerge successfully from the 7 Years' War was Great Britain. Even Great Britain's ally, her principal ally, Prussia, had been severely humbled. Frederick II of Prussia nearly went down in a mass of Russian infantry. An event known as the Potsdam Miracle saved him, the Hohenzollern dynasty, and the Kingdom of Prussia from complete collapse. The Empress Elizabeth died. The Russian Empress Elizabeth died, and her nephew Peter III succeeded her as Tsar Peter III. Now, Peter III was a German prince. He was the Russian Tsar, but he was an ethnic German. He had been reared in Germany, and he idolized Frederick the Great. He gave up all of Russia's hard-won conquest to Frederick the Great, to Frederick II. And for his part, Frederick II accepted the peace. He moved to garrison the area, but he was under no illusions about his military capacity and the fact that Prussia had only barely been saved. At this point, he was more reform-minded, and he was trying to keep as low a profile as possible in Germany. Indeed, when we look at Frederick the Great's career after the Seven Years' War, we find him not willing to engage himself in any European warfare. And the only territorial gains that he were able to get were through acting in concert with both Russia and Austria. Now, the British, they had consistently demonstrated that they could beat the colonists, but they had never delivered that big punch to the colonists. And Saratoga gave the French all they needed. They quickly came into alliance with the Continental Congress, and though Saratoga was nominally won by Horatio Gates, the battle had actually been won by his subordinate, Benedict Arnold. Saratoga to the British still wasn't a great calamity. They still had not realized what it meant to the colonists and what it meant to people looking to humble them. The British were still in a stronger position to the Americans, but the political ramifications were too immense. Great Britain now, with French entry into the war, had to replace their strategy to face the more dangerous French threat. Lord Howe resigned in the face of stinging criticism, and the criticism was rightly placed. And he was brought up on charges over his actions in North America, and he was replaced by Sir Henry Clinton. He successfully defended himself against all charges, but nonetheless, he would be embittered by wartime experiences. Now, Sir Henry Clinton withdrew his army from Philadelphia, and he was ordered to send a defensive force of 5,000 men to the West Indies, along with 13 ships of the line to defend against the coming French assault. He also was ordered to send 20 ships of the line back to Great Britain to defend home waters. And when he evacuated Philadelphia, 3,000 loyalists left with him. So you begin to see that the loyalists are now moving with the British Army. They have no intention. The more hardline loyalists have no intention of remaining with their patriots, primarily because of their preference to Britain, but also out of fear of what their neighbors would do to them. Now, Washington, having learned that Howe's army was not just military men on the move, but was now comprising civilians, decided to strike out from his dismal winter camp at Valley Forge and attack the rear guard of Trenton's army at Monmouth. But he was driven off from the action. And the action ended with the British simply resuming their march, but the Americans had gained confidence for standing up to the British. They viewed Monmouth as a victory because they had met the British and the British had marched off. They really didn't see it as a standoff. Now, one reason for this bold attitude among the American soldiers, among the Continental Army, was Baron Friedrich Wilhelm von Steuben. Now, von Steuben was a former Prussian drill officer who was now on Washington's staff. His salary was being paid by the money the Continental Congress was borrowing from the French monarchy, from the Kingdom of France. Von Steuben came in and he authored the regulations for the order and discipline of the troops of the United States, commonly known as the Blue Book. Von Steuben came in and he brought with him and gave to the Continental Army order, precision, discipline, self-confidence, and most importantly, competence to the Continental Army. They were now better trained and better led and better equipped because of the French money. They were now better equipped. Clinton had to contend with more serious threat to Great Britain's empire than Washington and this new model Continental Army. The French arrived in the West Indies in 1778. Very quick after their declaration, they arrived in the West Indies. And they captured Dominica, St. Vincent, and Grenada in quick succession. With the entry of France, North America, the colonies, the United States, became a secondary theater of war. Great Britain now had to defend all of her possessions from the West Indies to the East Indies, Africa, India, and most importantly, home waters. You do not want a French army landing in southern England or in Ireland. A French army landing in Ireland was a paramount fear for the British for the duration of their enmity toward France. Between 1778 and 1783, the conflict was now being fought globally, greatly straining Great Britain's war capacity. They were already under strain, having to find the men and resources to corral the United States. Now they had to defend around the world. It was a lot to bite off. And in 1789, the Spanish entered the war against the British in hopes, mainly in hopes of regaining Gibraltar. They would attack and attack and attack Gibraltar time and time again, but they were unable to take Gibraltar then or now. They did, however, succeed in wreaking havoc in the West Indies, notably capturing the Bahamas, and also in just wreaking havoc in the Floridas. They defeated British garrison after garrison after garrison in the Floridas under Galvez the Great. Galvez actually just went about the reconquest of Florida, humbling the British, but he never marched into Georgia. He never marched into Georgia. Even after the British had captured Savannah, he refused to march into Georgia. From Galvez, and really from all the other European combatants' perspective, the United States was a non-entity. Whether the British retained those colonies or not didn't matter to them. Avenging Spanish honor and retaking Florida, the Floridas for Spain, was a paramount to Galvez and every other Spanish officer. Likewise, the French could have immediately sent an army and a fleet to combat the British in the United States, but it wasn't in French interest. What the French wanted was to humble Great Britain, and most importantly, to gain Sugar Islands and trade posts from the British. That's what they wanted. That's what really drove the French declaration for war, breaking into the imperial trade of Great Britain. Now, with Galvez wreaking havoc in the Floridas, the Netherlands, not wanting to be left out, also declared war on Great Britain in 1780. And again, this was done to take trade posts, trade routes, and just interfere in Britain's imperial economic prosperity. Those were the primary motivations for the European powers to join in the war. Not American liberty, not American independence. And indeed, the Dutch declaration of war didn't even coincide with any American agreement. They simply did so because Great Britain was weak and she was isolated. John Paul Jones then captured, and John Paul Jones was a captain in service to the Continental Navy. He did something that nobody thought could ever occur. Leading a French squadron, he engaged the British in their home waters, and he captured the HMS Serapis. This was the full breaking of Britain's imperial facade. Much the same way that the Spanish Habsburgs had been humbled and their imperial facade had been broken by both the defeat of the Armada and the arrival of the buccaneers in the West Indies. Britain's imperial facade had been broken, but the capture of the imperial warship, the HMS Serapis, the fact that the British Navy was now coming under strain and fire and was unable to successfully defend itself in home waters, nonetheless, really sort of heralded the defeat of the British during this war. Now, French diplomacy was working wonders, working miracles in keeping Great Britain isolated from continental allies. All the continental powers of Europe, including the German princes who had loaned King George III their armies, refused to come to the British government's aid. They refused all attempts by the British government to come to some sort of understanding, some sort of alliance. And this all stemmed from the British success during the Seven Years' War. Now, Great Britain's prestige and power greatly expanded, and that upset the European balance of power. The other powers of Europe were all too happy to see Great Britain humbled. They were not joining in the war. This war that had been Great Britain's to lose was now becoming the war that they desperately needed to win against ever more mounting difficulties. Now, Clinton's new war plan unfolded like this. In 1780, he sent 3,000 men to raid Savannah, Georgia. The American resistance collapsed quickly in the face of the British assault. This weakness encouraged Clinton to send his subordinate, Lieutenant General Lord Cornwallis, Charles Cornwallis, the Marquis of Cornwallis, to campaign in the South and roll up the colonies one by one as quickly as possible so that they can end things here and that and so that the British Army Navy could focus elsewhere in defeating the Spanish and the French. Now, after taking Savannah, Cornwallis struck north, taking Charleston with ease. And by taking Charleston, he took 25,000 Americans prisoner. Loyalists now came flocking to the British. Now, to compound this, Henry Clinton, began raiding in New England. And unlike Howe or Gage, he felt no uneasiness about fully pressing the Americans. He burned New Bedford and New Haven. He persuaded the Iroquois to rampage on the New York and Pennsylvania frontier. He persuaded the Cherokee. He brought in the Cherokee to harass the Carolina and Georgia backwoods. The Shawnee, Wyandotte, and Miami were all brought in to attack the Pennsylvania frontier. He also extended Lord Dunmore's promise of freedom to any slave who joined the British war effort. And this brought in Colonel Ty. And Colonel Ty and his Black Brigade, who wreaked havoc in the Chesapeake Bay and lower New York and New Jersey areas. Slaves in general came flocking to the British Army. The British, who promised not only liberty but pay in exchange for wartime service. And served they did. Slaves joined the British Army and served as engineers, cooks, launderers, scouts, light infantry, raiding parties, and logisticians. And through all this, Washington was simply inactive. This led Congress to split his army, sending 14,000 troops to the southern theater to oppose Lord Cornwallis, who, under Horatio Gates, took his command and met Lord Cornwallis at Camden, where Gates was decisively defeated. Of all the battles of the Revolutionary War, I think Camden had to be the most striking, the most impressive victory. Cornwallis simply smashed Gates to pieces. Gates jumped on a horse, and it is said that he rode all the way from Camden, South Carolina, to Norfolk, North Carolina, without stopping. He put as much distance between him and the British as possible, and thereafter he simply rode off from the pages of history. He fades into obscurity at this point. Lord Cornwallis, victorious. But despite all this, the British position was far more perilous. The only active field army in North America was Lord Cornwallis' army. Everybody knew it. Everybody was observing it. Washington wasn't really in a helpless position. He understood that as long as Cornwallis was marching out there and defeating the American armies and so forth, the colonial resistance and so forth, he would have to weaken his army and garrison troops. Colonel Tide, the Iroquois, the Cherokee, they could all be dealt with in time. Washington understood. What Washington needed was for Cornwallis to weaken himself enough so that he could strike out at Cornwallis and effectively end the last British field army. And then Washington could piece by piece bring the garrisons that Cornwallis had left in place to heal. And then simply do what he do away with the native groups that were supporting the British war effort and Colonel Tyne and his Black Brigade. Now, Cornwallis, he had too few troops to hold and defend his position. The British cause, which had been on an upswing since Clinton's appointment, was now to sustain a terrible loss. At King's Mountain, 12,000 loyalists under Major Patrick Ferguson were completely annihilated. Thomas Sumter and Francis Marion, they then began to attack and to raid Lord Cornwallis' supply lines. Now, the Americans were just as in bad a shape as the British. There was a lot of discontent brewing in the American ranks. Benedict Arnold was very angered at what he perceived to be Congress's lack of appreciation for his contribution to the war effort. He was heavily in debt. He had married a loyalist woman, and he had a child with his wife. He was just overall embittered with the treatment, and he was contemplating whether he had done the right thing in joining this rebellion against Great Britain. His wife used her contacts amongst loyalists to enter into communications with Sir Henry Clinton. Clinton and Arnold began to discuss plans to bring about the surrender of West Point. Washington liked Arnold. He viewed Arnold as the son he never had. George Washington famously never had any children of his own. Or any acknowledged children of his own. He viewed Washington as a sort of surrogate son, and he did all he could to further Arnold's career before Congress. And he had managed to get Arnold a position. He had actually wanted Arnold to be in charge of the Southern Army, the army that Gates was given command of. But Arnold was still nursing injuries from his actions at Saratoga. But he managed to win Arnold the position as the garrison commander of West Point. And West Point sort of challenged. West Point was the last American fort that challenged the British for control of New York. Arnold now begins to contemplate surrendering West Point for a substantial fee, a substantial amount of money, and a command in the British Army, along with the rank of Major General. He decided to go along with it, and West Point is only saved at the last moment when subordinate officers find out what Arnold is up to, and Arnold had to make a hasty retreat. to compound this, 1,700 Pennsylvania militiamen decided to march on Philadelphia to confront the Continental Congress because they had not been paid their back wages. Clinton, again, sent agents. He entered into communications with those men, and he attempts to persuade them to join the British, offering back pay and pardons to any man who joined. Now, this failed, and all of his agents were hung by the militiamen. The militiamen were not interested in going back on the British rule. They were now crafting their own opinions on what American independence meant. And they wanted redress from their legislature, from their Congress. They did not want to return to the British Parliament. Now, Lord Cornwallis, by 1781, only had 13,000 men fit for duty, and only about 3,000 soldiers total under his command. There was an additional 5,000 soldiers stationed between Savannah and Charleston, but they were needed for garrison duty. In particular, they were needed to guard those positions from the French Navy that was now actively patrolling the American coast. And the French were well aware that South Carolina and Georgia, the low tide area, was very profitable. If the French could manage to capture those areas, if they defeated the British for it, then they would simply argue to the British that they conquered it and it was now a French colony. Irregardless to any sort of opinion they or feeling they would have had with the Americans. Again, no one is really treating American independence as a priority except for the Americans. The European powers are looking to increase their prestige in Europe and gain colonies and trade routes and better and generally just better themselves economically. Now, Cornwallis decided to move to Wilmington, North Carolina to be resupplied by the sea and enter into communications with Henry Clinton. After Camden, Gates had been replaced by Nathaniel Greene, another officer, junior officer, who Washington was favorably disposed to. Now, Greene reorganized the Southern Army, and spearheaded a new series of campaigns. First of these battles will be the Battle of Hanna's Cowpens. Now, Banastre Tarleton and 1,100 men were lured into a battle at Hanna's Cowpens, where the colonial militia was dangled out in front of them almost as bait and lured Tarleton into attacking, thinking that he could simply gain a quick victory over the colonial militia. He gave the command for a charge, and as soon as the British were in full swing with their bayonets, he decided to launch his cavalry to ensure that there'd be no escape for the colonists. And right as the British were fully committed to their charge, the militia melted away to reveal the Continentals, who mowed down the British. Now, the fighting was brutal, very sanguine, and only about 140 mounted troops escaped, Tarleton being one of them. After this, Cornwallis had the strikeout, and at Guilford Courthouse, he scored a victory, driving back Greene, but his army was in bad shape. When he arrived at Wilmington, he was again disappointed. He was greeted by the French Navy, who were preventing his resupply. So at this point, he decided to embark on a lengthy march upcountry to Virginia to establish contact with James Phipps in the Chesapeake and await resupply from Clinton in New York. Now, all things came to a head in June of 1781. The French army promised in 1778 finally arrived. Washington, realizing that the moment he had waiting for was now at hand, took his forces down to Virginia and clamped down on Lord Cornwallis by land, who was blocked from the sea from escaping by the French Navy, who had scattered the British Navy at the Battle of the Chesapeake. now tramped by Washington and its Continentals, the Comte de Rochambeau, the Comte Rochambeau by land, and the Comte de Grasse by sea. He was forced to surrender after 3 months of heavy bombardments and the French storming of his defensive positions on land. With the surrender of Lord Cornwallis, the American theater sort of ends. The war in the United States ends in 1781 with Cornwallis' surrender. The war would continue for another 2 years because, as I stated earlier, American independence was never really a war aim for the French, the Spanish, or the Dutch. They wanted colonies. They wanted to embark Great Britain. They wanted to increase their economic vitality. Now, with Cornwallis' defeat, there was no troops available for future offensive actions. The war ground to a halt, with New York City, Charleston, and Savannah still being held by the British. By the British, sorry about that. And the British were now in a truly helpless position because the Spanish were still striking out deep into the Floridas. Now, by 1782, the war was costing Parliament £20 million a year to wage. The colonies simply weren't worth it anymore. Parliament voted to suspend the war against the colonies in North America by a slim margin of 234 to 215. Lord North's government duly collapsed, and he was soon replaced by Lord Rockingham, who came back to power. But Lord Rockingham died shortly after assuming power and was replaced by William Petty, the second Earl of Shelburne. Now, Shelburne decided to open negotiations with Benjamin Franklin, who at this time was in France, and they began to secretly correspond with each other. Now, a provisional agreement guaranteeing independence was okayed, and in an effort to sort of head off the French returning to North America, the British decided to cede all the lands south of the Great Lakes and east of the Mississippi to the United States, granting the United States this sort of enlarged national power, national entity. Remember, the Americans made no strikes, no movements west of the Appalachian Mountains. They were still firmly British, but to sort of stave off the French or the Spanish from taking those lands, they gave those lands to a nominal ally to those nations. Now, the United States, the Americans, one of the big effect of all this was that they lost British protection and benefits at home and abroad. South Carolina alone accrued almost £3 million of debt. 5,000 slaves ran away to the British in Georgia, 20,000 in South Carolina. By 1782, the Continental Congress and the states had issued almost £440 million in paper currency. The inflation rate soared to between 1,900 and 5,000 in some places. Per capita income fell by 45% between the war years. That's the equivalent of the stock market crash and the Great Depression. And most importantly, thousands of loyalists left. And the loyalists were the cream of the crop of the British American colonies. And most notably, Richard Franklin, the son of Benjamin Franklin, was a loyalist, and he left when the loyalists left. Richard Franklin also had the distinction of being the last royal governor of New Jersey. Just to sort of wrap things up, just to sort of sum things up, the Articles of Confederation that we discussed in our past lectures was only ratified by all of the states mere months before the action at Yorktown, before the Great American Victory at Yorktown. African Americans, the ideas of the revolution fell tragically short and deprived African Americans, fully one-fifth of the population in the 1770s, of any of those of any of those lofty ambitions, any of those lofty goals. They were left either mired in bondage or forced to live on the margins of freedoms. The slave-based economies of the South, producing the cash crops of tobacco and cotton, rice and indigo for export, enabled slavery to survive the revolution, since these Southern elites, including George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, were slave owners, and they were not willing to financially ruin themselves simply to grant liberty to the African Americans. This made slavery a very necessary toleration to the young republic. As I noted earlier, loyalists were leaving. They were following the British Army. 25,000 loyalists moved to Nova Scotia after the war. 20,000 moved to Quebec, which became less French and less Catholic as a result. Overall, it's estimated that 100,000 loyalists left the United States after the war. A further 3,000 loyalists would leave the South and move to the Bahamas after the war. Conciliation with colonists was now very understood by the British, and they never again faced the type of opposition or rebellion in their colonies that they have faced amongst the North American colonies, the now United States. And now African Americans, those who stayed were mired in either slavery or forced to walk a tightrope for liberty. But many others left. The black loyalists left. The legacy is bittersweet. The revolution's legacy is bittersweet for African Americans. The African Americans who joined the British cause went into exile with the whites who left. Some went to live in Nova Scotia, where lingering racism, resentment, poor farming lands, and of course that terrible cold, that terrible Canadian cold, led them to emigrate once again, this time to Sierra Leone or the Bahamas, though an unfortunate few were returned to slavery. The war was a very bad military reverse for the British, but not the death of the empire. Most of their colonies stayed out of the conflict, and the West Indian colonies, the most profitable of all, were never going to rebel. The institution of slavery and the slave owners